This is our league, and this is your league. From the 55-yard line on CFL America Radio and the Sports History Network.
This is a league of A's and BCs. It's green and red and gold and black and blue. This is a league with two official languages and many unofficial languages. It's East versus West, wheat versus iron, love versus hate. This is a league where superstars are extraordinary and ordinary at the same time. It's a league of ice, of fog, of mud and wind. And for one Sunday in November, it's the nation's glue. This is a league as diverse as a country, a league of Jacksons and Kwongs, Johnsons, Moscas, O'Shea's, and Haji Razulis. This is his league, her league, and their league. It's my league, and it's your league. This is our league.
Welcome to From the 55-Yard Line with Scott Adamson and Greg James. And we are here for our second podcast with noted historian and author Roy Rosmos, who is a CFL historian, a very noted CFL historian, who has written four books on the history of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Roy, welcome.
Thank you. Hi, Roy.
How you doing, buddy?
And so for the audience out there, it took us a few tries here as we're learning the technology as we go. And Roy, thank you for your patience as this is our third take on an introduction. So my apologies for sitting there patiently as we kind of sort this all out. So
I'm just gonna call you Roy, because I mean, with my last name, people get it wrong all the time. So, you know,
understand that's no problem.
Well, thank you guys for being patient. And as I said in the opening, we are speaking with Roy today about the history of football in Winnipeg. Our first episode, it was Scott and I sitting down talking about the history of pro football in Birmingham. Well, today we are moving up north of the border, actually directly kind of north of where I'm at in Chicago, up to Winnipeg. Roy, yep. Let me ask you, as you and I have talked before, extensively before our broadcast, and I'll throw out the first question here is, you've written four books on the Blue Bombers.
Yep.
We do a podcast here, and I know Scott's written a book, but the books you have written, not only are they beautiful, I mean, they are, as books go, history books go, they're beautiful books. That's the only way to describe them. And I have, over the summer, Roy was kind enough to send me all four books. And it took a while for them to get here because of the pandemic. And when I got them, they were just, looking through them and like, oh my God, they're coffee table books. I mean, these are not just books you grab right out. These are books that you lay out. I mean, definitely coffee table books. And Roy, my question is, What made you decide to not only write one book, but a series of books?
Well, you know, we talked earlier, I don't want to confuse people about the books and the way they go, but it all started with the first book, which isn't a numbered book. It's not a volume book because it's about the greatest player to ever play football in Winnipeg. And I told you earlier, greatest player to ever play football either side of the border. But you know what? Come back to that later. What happened was I worked for a lot of years as a corporate liaison for Variety Children's Charity in Manitoba. And we were doing these dinners called the Hearts of Blue and Gold with blue and gold bomber colors. And I called up my hero, Kenny Plain, Iowa Hawkeye. first quarterback to ever win a Rose Bowl for Iowa. And he's been here all his life since he came here in 1957. We're sitting, we're talking, and my hero, I'm, you know, my eyes falling out of my head with my hero. And I'm thinking, there's nothing out there about him. I mean, Wikipedia, this, that. Said, no one ever wrote a book. And my buddy Wayne turns to me and says, well, you know more about the Bombers, probably the CFL, than anybody else. Why don't you write it? So I said, okay. So I got involved with Kenny and I wrote this book. That first book, which is actually a companion book to the other four volumes of the entire history, was like I said, a bio, and it was the greatest. We call it the golden years here in the CFL in Winnipeg, when the Bombers from 57 to 67 won those four great cups, four out of five. And this guy was so unbelievable. So I did it. I didn't care. It sure didn't make me any money. I didn't care. This is my hero, my Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Now, after I got finished that, I thought, what about the rest of the history? There's nothing anywhere. So, okay, dive back in. 12 years later, I'm writing all these volumes from 1930, as you said, that first book, The Beginnings, to the last Grey Cup in 2019. And that was my passion, was to, I want the younger fans, I want everybody to know everything about this team, because we are an incredible franchise here in Winnipeg with the firsts and everything that's been done. So I'll cut it off there, because I'll talk forever. Your next question.
No, I'm talking forever. That's what we want you to do. That's great. And that's what really fascinates me. I was going to ask, are you a lifelong fan? I mean, was this something when, you know, you're a little boy, you become a huge football fan? I mean, how sort of did that work in terms of you becoming a Winnipeg super fan?
Well, yeah, I started watching it in 1956. Whoa. And then 57, Kenny Plain came here and I started to watch it. And then all of a sudden I was sucked in. So 60 some years, 50 years a season ticket holder.
Wow.
I finally, that's another whole story. I didn't like the way they were doing things when they moved the stadium and everything. That's another whole long story. But yeah, and through that time, the gist of these books are pretty simple. They're my personal, I saw it all, talking to the players, talking to the media, getting the newspaper articles, getting the research done. This history is so different from any, I believe, so different from any other. It's a lot of pictorial, short, succinct stories, I'm sure you've read, but mm-hmm. through the eyes of the players. And to me, I want to honor the players. And that's why I did this. So yeah, over 60 years, Scott.
Well, I'm just thinking too, I mean, right with the Bud Grant era, from being, you know, a player with five interceptions against Saskatchewan to becoming a coach at 29. I mean, that's a heck of an era to really become a fan of the Blue Bombers.
More than you know, because actually five interceptions in one game, but in the second game in that series, he had two more. So seven interceptions in two games. And this guy was a multi, I don't know if you look that up, he was a basketball star. He could have played basketball. I mean, the guy, how lucky were we to have Bud Grant come to Winnipeg he played here, and then at 29, you're right. And so all of a sudden he's got like the golden years, 57 to 67, and he's got great cups coming out of his eyeballs. This guy with the Fox, as they called him here. We used to call him the Fox. There is a statue outside of the new Winnipeg Stadium, which is called IG, which is Investors Group Field, with Bud Grant.
God, that's amazing. I mean, to just think that, you know, you were kind of on the ground floor of his legend. I mean, that's what's so fun for me to read about and to hear you talk about.
Well, and I'm glad you like that. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff I couldn't mention. He was so close to his players, but he also knew how to be pragmatic when they were on the field. He used to take them hunting. He used to, like Kenny Plain and him, I mean, that's like, okay, that's Belichick and Brady. That's Seifert before him and Montana. This, the two of them together. And he would come and pick the boys up to go hunting. 6 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, and the boys would go And, you know, they just had such an incredible relationship here.
Yeah, if you're going to take them hunting, you better make sure you do have a good relationship, I would think.
I'm thinking the vice president here. Yeah.
All this is just fascinating to me because, I mean, I'm one of those kids that grew up in Alabama, like Dieter Brock, you know, which is, he was sort of my gateway into the CFL, you know, because he was already a legend. And I mean, he's a Birmingham native, started out at Auburn, played at Jacksonville State, and then he, you know, goes on to Winnipeg. So a lot of people in the South that maybe had not been familiar with the CFL, he's what made them familiar with it. And that, good grief, that guy could throw a football a mile. That was just unbelievable.
Oh, well, you know his nickname here, right? The Birmingham Rifle.
Yep.
That guy could throw holes through the wind. I used to watch that guy say, holy shit, man, can that guy throw? Oops, sorry. We probably shouldn't be doing that. But I mean, oh, yeah, this guy could go down on his knees and throw an 80-yard ball. His problem was he ran into the Edmonton Eskimo dynasty. Mm-hmm. It was all over. I mean, there should have been one, two, maybe even three Grey Cups, but wrong time, wrong place. But, yeah, Dieter was something. He was a bit of an enigma here. The Southern boys were, okay? They were kind of back offish. They were here. They played for us. Dieter only wanted to do things right. He was very misunderstood here, okay? Because he wasn't like Kenny Plain came, played, and stayed. Became part of the community, did everything. Don Jonas in another book, same thing. Dieter, not so much. And he was pilloried a lot, okay, in the press and with a lot of fans. But by the same token, he gave his all the time. And I did love the guy.
Yeah, I'd wonder what his relationship was, because obviously it's different depending on the athlete. But, you know, so many you hear that when they go to Canada, especially when they spend a lot of years there, I mean, they just love it. I mean, they love not just the game, but they love, you know, they love the country. And that's always cool to hear to me.
Well, we got a whole bunch. I was telling Greg earlier, I've got this one of the sections. I'm not sure which book it's in. Maybe it's probably in every book, but I call it They Played and They Stayed. We got so many guys come to this, the Great White North. And in the end, they love it so much. They play, they stay, they live their lives here. We're Winnipeg, a great big small or small big town. And the community here embraces these guys. If they embrace us back, then you're here forever. Dieter, well, that was a different story. I guess in the end, well, because of that trade in 83, he kind of maybe a little bit wore out his welcome because he wanted even more money. But, you know, he did a good job here. And a poor guy goes to Hamilton, and then we crushed him in the 84 Grey Cup because we got Tom Clements. Tom Clements, Fighting Irish. He comes here, right? And we send we send Dieter there. But you know what? Dieter's he holds most of the Bomber passing records to this day.
Well, I love, you know, I'm a Ticats fan. The reason I became a Ticats fan, it's really scientific because they had black and gold colors, and I like their logo. And I'm a kid growing up in Birmingham, Alabama. I have no ties to any of these teams. So that's how I settled on the Ticats.
That's okay. But, yeah, well, there's something for you history-wise. So, okay, I'm going to crush you now, Scott. Okay.
Okay.
57, we got about 80,000 guys on the injury list, and the Ticats crush us. And they crush Kenny Plain. This young guy comes here. Now, 58, we beat them. 59, we beat them. 61, we beat them. 62, we beat them. 84, we beat them. And 2019. So we kind of got it up on the boys.
Yeah, I think payback. I think you got it there for sure.
I'm thinking.
But I've always envied guys like you and Greg because you live in a town that have a team that you can love. You know, with me in Birmingham, the teams come and go. You know, they may last a year, sometimes 3 years. But you guys have, you know, like Greg with the Bears, you've grown up with the Blue Bombers. It's just got to be special from a fan standpoint.
It is, you know, when you have that, when you have that connection, which is harder to do nowadays, because of the, I went over that with Gray because of the contracts and stuff like that, and guys coming and going. There was a time when guys played their whole careers with one team. Well, you don't see a lot of that anymore. Okay. And so you can get into it, and these guys are in the community, and they're out there, they're raising funds, or they're talking to you or something, and they become part of your life and you become part of their life. And that's why they stay. So yeah, we do have that, obviously. Not as much anymore. This last group, the 2019 Grey Cup champs, there's a whole bunch of them that have stayed in the city. And they've become part of it. And you're right, Scott, that is, that's a key component of team and about history and a franchise.
Well, too, I mean, the thing to me that I think a lot of people probably don't realize is the community ownership of the team. I mean, you hear about that, you know, I know recently, a couple of years ago, the Packers were, you know, selling shares, but basically it was just, you got a plaque and you gave them $300 or something, but it's different in Winnipeg, isn't it? I mean, they really are a community owned team.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. We're a bunch of crazy maniacs here. We want to own our players, and we want them to own us, and we want them to be part of us, and we want to be part of them. And you know, rough times, good times, we just want to do it all together. And that's what makes a franchise like Winnipeg so incredible. In fact, I guess in the CFL today, there's Winnipeg, Saskatchewan, Edmonton. I think that's it for community-owned teams.
Wow. Still, though, that's, you know, probably if I could go back in time, knowing now what I, or knowing then what I know now, I'd have probably become a Blue Bombers fan. That's got to be pretty cool to know that this is
quite
literally
buddy.
Your team.
I love that. I love that. Welcome.
You got to give me a time machine, though. See, we can't go back in time. That's the problem.
I guess not, but that's good of you to say that. Yeah.
And Greg, aren't you a Toronto guy, Greg? Aren't you?
I'm more of a Toronto guy, and a lot of that for me is a lot of that is based on the Argos history with Chicago.
Yeah,
because Argos, the Argos just, and the Car and my Cardinals have played twice. They played once in the 50s, and they played I think once in the 60s during those NFL CFL exhibition games.
Not the Cardinals. Just a minute. Okay.
Now the Cardinals. Yeah. Yeah. The Cardinals. The Chicago Cardinals played the Argonauts, and I think it was 59. And yeah. Then after they moved to St. Louis, they played the Argonauts again. So to me, it's my fandom of the Argonauts is based partially on history, but I'm also a big believer in the underdog and seeing those empty seats in Toronto.
Okay, so now it's time to start frothing. It makes me absolutely nuts. They're driving me absolutely bonkers in so many cities. No, I mean 6-8 million people, and you're going to tell me you can't get 20,000 people? I think it's the marketing to start with. Now, do you guys aware of Mike Pinball Clemens?
Oh yeah,
Okay,
now this guy. I saw him here in Winnipeg talking about it. This guy is one of the most incredible proponents of football in Canada. Okay. And he's running the Argonauts now. But you see, the problem is Toronto, I hate to say it, they got this US syndrome where nothing's good unless it's NFL. And yet the Argos, they've got the most great cups in Canada. Okay. In fact, which pains me, they beat us 4 times in a row in the 40s. And that's the only team we've never beaten in the Grey Cup, Winnipeg. And I look at it and I say, you know what? There's all kinds of room for stuff like that. So, yeah, we like to have the Argonauts. But, you know, Toronto, I'm going to get any Canadian people listening to this from the East are going to hate me. But that's the problem. Toronto considers themselves the center of the universe, basically. And if it ain't Toronto, it ain't worth shit. And that's the problem. And you know what? So good on you liking the Argonauts. And yes, you're right. They did play. And that brings me to another one. Well, my beginnings book. I don't know if you saw that. But actually, here's another first. Winnipeg Blue Bombers were the first team in the CFL. Well, it wasn't the CFL then, in Canadian football, to beat an American pro football team that was in first place, the Columbus Bullies, in 1941.
Oh. And now, see, I did not know that. And I don't know, Scott, did you realize that? I did not know that.
Yeah, we beat them 19-12 here in Winnipeg. Now, three-game series after that, I guess they got their footing, but it also had to do with the way they played the rules. They beat us quite, because like the history books will tell you, they'll say, well, the only CFL team to beat an American team was the Hamilton Tiger Cats beat Buffalo, I think, in 61 or something. But nobody realizes 1941, they came here and we stuffed it to them 19-12, Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Columbus Bullies. I got their uniforms. I got everything. They were the old AFL, I guess. And they were
the first version of the American. That's what I love about these podcasts. I learned something new every time I listen to a podcast.
And this is something I'll bet you know that I've always wondered. When they did play the games, when it was an American team against a Canadian team, were they hybrid rules? Or if you played in Canada, did you play Canadian rules and play in America, American rules? How did that work? Because I've never really read any real explanation of that.
Yeah, and those years in the 50s and early 60s and that, they were doing sort of a combination of hybrid, but it was basically the Canadian rules. I think one game, it was different. One game was one half Canadian, the other half was American, but it was basically Canadian rules. But I mean, we just, you know, I mean, by then, by the 60s, I mean, you know, the NFL football was really ramping up at that point, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, there were, it's all over the place, Scott. It's all over the place. All I know is, I think that's what happened in 41, was the first game was Canadian rules. And then the second and third game was American rules, and they beat us two in a row. But we were the first ones we can say, just a minute. What did I say? 1941. So 1941, were we? 35. Yes. 1941, we were the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. In 1935, when Winnipeg won the first Grey Cup for the West, and the first that changed football in Canada forever, because it did lead to the formation of the CFL eventually, because no one had won it before then. An incredible thing, because we had to go in those days when you went east to the, because yeah, in those days the east ruled everything, okay? So you had to go east and you had to play eastern rules after playing western rules all year long. And we had this crazy little bugger called Fritzy Hansen, and this guy was unbelievable. I mean, I mean, one of the Hamilton players after the game, we beat them 18-12, said, no wonder we couldn't beat you. You had a greyhound running down the ball all day. Because there was no blocking. Another thing ticks me off that I talked to the CFL about, but they do not show his record. He had over 300 yards returning kicks in that game.
Oh, my God. 300 yards just in kick returns.
Kick return. And there was no blocking in those days. And his final one was a 78-yard punt return for the touchdown to win the game. It changed everything.
And why does the CFL just not recognize records going back that far?
Well, here we go again. I'm going to get in trouble because the CFL is so full of shit. You know what? They don't look at that stuff. They grab whatever happens to be there and they say, this is it. But they won't show it as a record. I mean, over 300, and they know that because I got my hands on the scorecards. See, the field was muck and poop and everything in that time of year, right? So they said we can't tell. But you know, the yard markers were there. Hello, You know, over, well, actually, I think it was closer to 329. Now that's kick and punt returns, right? No blocking. He's coming through. Fritzy Hansen, his nickname was the Golden Ghost or the Galloping Ghost. Nobody could stop this boy.
And in terms of history, so does a team recognize that record, or is it just the league just doesn't recognize it?
You know who recognizes it, my friend? Me and the book. And I'm yelling and screaming at everybody, and I'll choke everybody because it's there. No, the team. Yeah, I there's another whole podcast that's going to get me thrown in jail. Come on guys, be who you are. It's there. The records are there. I found this stuff. I spent 12 years digging and scratching and crawling and digging this stuff up and finding it, talking to players. So, yeah, it's real. It's real, Greg. But for whatever reason, I can't tell you.
Okay. Well, and that kind of, as we're talking here, I'm just thinking about what you were saying about the league and the team. And in terms of the history of the Bombers,
yeah,
and I know this is not – up in Edmonton, they do not have a Hall of Fame. But I know in, say, in Green Bay, they've got a Hall of Fame down there with that preserves their past. In Chicago
– unbelievable.
In Chicago, we really don't have one, but that's partially – from what I understand, due to a fire that erased a lot of Chicago memorabilia back, I don't know if it was in the 50s or the 60s, but a fire took out a lot of the history other than what was in print. But with the Blue Bombers, how do they look at their history? How do they honor their history?
They don't, and that's okay. Am I in shit later? Okay. I don't care. It's often said there's two things, you know, if you're an honest man and you got nothing to lose, you can say the truth. And I'm both of those. So you see, the Bombers had the same thing. They had it wasn't a fire. It was a combination of a little bit of fire and a flood years back that lost most of the stuff. Okay. I buy that. All right. But I'm sitting here. I call myself the little Polish kid from East Elmwood in Winnipeg that said, you know what? I'm going to find it. 12 years worth of finding it. I dug and I found and I found. It just takes a bunch of crazy idiots like me in every city like Chicago and the rest of them to go out there and say, you know what? I'm going to do this. And so when you say about that, you have I'll give them credit to a certain degree. They got a pretty good sports writer there by the name of Ed Tate that they brought from the Winnipeg Free Press, and he's doing some good work. But there's nobody got what I got. And you got to go deep. You got to go deep. You got to dig and you got to find those newspaper articles. Yeah. And I got this fantastic lady that has this research capability that finds me the stuff in these stories. And I just keep digging to find that. It's so, I'm getting young people. It's so important. So important. You go by the Walk of Fame at the Winnipeg Stadium and the names, Jim Hyten, whoever. And go, oh yeah, he's a famous guy. Yeah. So what about him? Well, he's in my book. Okay. Not just a name. Let's find out who he was. What did he do? How is he? Where is he now? And that's the premise behind my books. And it's a labor of love for me. So they could be doing a lot more in a lot of ways. I'm just not sure, but I don't care. That's why I'm putting this together once and for all. When this is finished, I've tried to honor so many of these guys that need to be honored and their stories need to be told. And they're going to be in print once and for all, not just somewhere on a plaque. And that's my whole thing.
And with that said, and the four books that I have in my possession as football history books go, and I've got a lot of them, if you can see here, sitting here in my, my reading room, I have quite a few. And looking at your books, there's the one thing that struck me about your books is the attention to detail and the attention to there's pictures in newspaper articles, not just reprints, but actual newspaper articles. So my question, and the question actually comes from Superfan 56 Park, the Superfan 56 Parkies on Twitter,
yep,
who asked me, hey, ask Roy where he got his picks from. So okay. I'm guessing you spent a lot of time in the library.
No, I'm so fortunate. A lot of time on the internet, but I just had this lady. I can't give her name because she would kill me. She has this degree in, I don't even know what the hell you call it, bibliography. Anyway, she can hit a button on her computer and find anything anywhere in any year. So I got her to find those. That's how I found those. And that's why I reprinted those articles as they were. Because I really appreciate what you said about attention to detail, because you're right. My books are different, not patting myself on the back, but they're different from anything I've ever seen historically, because they're about through my eyes,
right,
through the player's eyes, and through the newspaper articles and the people that wrote about it, which gives a personal touch to the whole thing. It's you're there. Yeah. You're here. You go, oh shit, you're reading this stuff. And that's what I wanted. And the stories are short and succinct. Didn't want to do the old, you know, history book. God bless the old history books, 900 pages of writing with 14 pictures. No, mine are exactly the opposite. Let's have some stunning pictures. And finding some of those photographs were unbelievable. But you see, made friends with so many of these ex-players. They send me these photographs that nobody's seen before, or I find them in the newspaper. Okay, here's a somewhat inane, but interesting, I think. Fellow by the name of Paul Williams in Winnipeg. You'll find him in Jonah's book, 27 or 29. Anyways, he was nicknamed Northern Dancer. Reason he was he comes floating down, right on my side, comes floating down the field, gets a touchdown, and goes into this dance. Well, people are going absolutely bonkers, Northern Dance. So I looked it up. He is the first player in pro football to do an end zone dance. Now, there was somebody, huh. I've got it in my book, I don't want to pull it up right now. You had a guy in college in 1961 or 62 do an end zone dance. But in pro football, he was the first one to do an end zone dance. That's where it all started.
Wow. Wow. And here I thought it was Billy White Shoes Johnson down here for the Oilers.
No, it was. Yeah, sorry. That was our boy, Paul Williams, number 27, number 29. I can't remember. Northern Dancer. I apologize. I'm supposed to be this big shot historian, but I got these books and I have, you know, I have, hello, who am I talking to and who are you?
Well, I mean, that gets me into the next question I wanted to ask in terms of, you know, just talking about the CFL. The CFL has a lot of firsts in pro football that on this side of the border, they never get credit for at all.
Right.
So when it comes to the Blue Bombers, what are some of the first that the Blue Bombers are really not recognized for?
Well, I think I told you, now I'm getting in trouble with this again, but it's in the book. Quotes Indian, Jack Jacobs, as he was called, came from your side of the border, from University of, I think it was Colorado, I can't remember. Anyways, played for the Packers, came here because he could play quarterback. First quarterback either side of the border to throw for over 3,000 yards.
Wow.
Okay. I said Winnipeg Blue Bombers first to beat this. We got Bud Grant. Now, I'm not sure because I'm this one I don't know for sure, but I know Bud Grant was the first coach in Canada to 100 victories. I think Hallis might have had more than that. I'm not sure. George Hallis?
I don't know. I don't know. You're talking about in terms of the time period, the quickest to 100 victories.
Yeah, the quickest 200 victories. I think Hallis might, but we had that.
It might have actually. I think it might have been John Madden, at least down here, if memory serves me correctly.
Well, Madden was in the 70s, though, right?
Yeah, but the seasons were longer too. But again, that's one of those things that I used to tell the Admiral when he would ask me a tough question during a briefing. I have to look that up for you. But yeah, I'll have to see. I have to see down here in terms of, you know, who was the first one to 100 victories. But you were saying up there.
Yep.
The first person.
I'm sorry. Yeah. The first person in Canada to do 100 victories. Well, like I said, you got me. Because I don't have my books in front of me. There's a bunch of others either side of the border. I'm trying to remember for interceptions. I don't want to go into it right now, but yeah, a lot of firsts for the Winnipeg Blue, a lot of firsts for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. But that one about the 3,000 yards throwing really sticks in my mind.
And in terms of the history of the Bombers as it relates to America down here, and correct me if I'm wrong, but weren't the Blue Bombers one of the first CF Canadian teams to bring in American players? Or were they?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, that's a good one. Yes and no. In those years, early years, Canadian teams would go down south and find Billy Bob or whoever it was, and they'd bring him up here because he could play football real good. Okay, fine. We had one, we had two. And then what was happening here, by the mid-30s, the boys here in Winnipeg were looking, staying so frustrated with the East, the way the East was treating us in the West, because they didn't want the West to win. I mean, it was horrible the way, I mean, we had to follow everything they said. So I said, okay, look, I've got the article, in fact, it's interesting, might even be in the book, I can't remember. They said, you know what? Okay, boys, this is it. We're going for it. If we can't do it now, we're pulling out. We're not going to play for the Grey Cup anymore, which could have been the end of Canadian football, you know, as a league. So what they did was they went out with a program of looking for the players they needed. And again, it's in that book, The Beginnings, you'll find it. They brought in seven or eight Americans, but with pointed ideas. He plays here, he plays here. This guy does this, this guy does that. Well, boom, Grey Cup. Now, here's another one. You'll find CFL drives me nuts again. They'll tell you that the 1948 Calgary Stampeders were the first undefeated CFL team. Not true. The 1935 Winnipegs, as they were called, were the first undefeated. Now, they played a longer schedule, but the Winnipegs played a 12-game schedule, including American teams as warm-ups. Beat them all, never lost a game. That team was, that's where that Fritzy Hansen guy was telling you. Fritz, I'll go with that because his real name is something else. But Fritzy, and those other guys that came up here, we had this guy by the name of Russ Rebels. They called him the Wisconsin Wraith. He was like the ghost. He was from Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. We had these guys, a fellow by the name of Bert Oja came from the States, another guy who stayed here. But yeah, that was, we started something that made the CFL look at making rules for imports.
Okay.
When we brought those boys in. So again, another first for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
And when it comes, you know, talking about the time period, the 1940s, was during the war, did the Blue Bombers, the name Blue Bombers, does that come from the influence of the Royal Canadian Air Force up in Winnipeg during the war? Or
no, that's interesting. Blue Bomber, to bring up.
Where did the Blue Bomber name come from?
You're going to love this. I got a guy, Vince Leah, L-E-A-H, Vince Lee. Uncle Vince, they call him here, was the pride of Winnipeg and Canada in his writing. He was watching a game in 1936, I think it was. And Winnipeg's were all over this team, and he looked down the field and he said, look at those Blue Bombers hammering that team, which he admitted was a reference to the Brown Bomber, your boxer.
Lewis, yeah.
Lewis, yeah. And the name stuck in 1936, the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. That's where that came from. Look at them Blue Bombers down there doing the number on that team. So, yeah, that's where it came from. Before that, we were just the Winnipegs.
And during the war, I know there were military teams that competed for the Grey Cup, correct?
That's in the book again. That's sort of a mishmash. What happened was that there were so many guys overseas that they were putting teams together with whatever they could put teams together with. And, they would, one Grey Cup, they would wear the RAF symbol in front of it. But the only year they didn't play was, I think it was 45, but they played all the way through there, and they just fought their way through it and did it with army guys and with regular guys.
Okay. Right. After the war, when everything, life got back to normal, there were eight major teams playing Canadian pro football, correct? Or were there more?
The West was the tough one. Okay. The East always had those four guys. But we were the two major teams that were always there in the West were Winnipeg and Regina.
Okay.
You had Calgary in and out. You had Edmonton in and out. And then BC was sort of on the periphery, came in 50, 56 or 57.
Okay.
But that's what we had here. I mean, the actual formation of the CFL as it is today was 1958.
Okay.
That's when it became the CFL.
I know when I started following it in the early 70s, they would show on U.S. television, they would have truncated games that they would show in the summer. It usually wasn't on game night. It was like a couple of days late. But, you know, in the U.S., we didn't know who won. So it was just like watching an hour version of a CFL game. But I remember thinking how odd it was that there was the Saskatchewan Rough Riders and the Ottawa Rough Riders. You know, I thought they're only separated because they've separated their nickname, but I realized later there was a reason they're, you know, why each had their name. But you know, when you're a kid, you don't know.
No, when the East and the West, but yeah, okay. So just okay, once again, just only a couple seconds because I don't want to froth being an old man. this Ottawa Red Blacks makes me want to puke, but that's okay. And that's the kids. That's the up-to-date thing. You know, you could have called them a night. Even the Renegades was better than that. But, yeah, they got away from that. And, there was Rough Riders East and Rough Riders West.
I at least like the Renegades logo. Yeah, I'm like you. I'm not a huge fan of
Red. The Renegades either. Logo is one of my favorite CFL logos. That
it was cool.
You got a beaver on it. You got a maple leaf.
Yeah. It was a really beautiful logo, you know. The two of them. At least we still got the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and I got if you ever get to the beginnings book, I got some great. Now, okay, you guys aware of the biggest weekend in Canadian football, the Labor Day game?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Labor Day Classic. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, and then of course the follow up, which is the Banjo Bowl in Winnipeg. Mm-hmm. We play there, the Labor Day, they play the Banjo Bowl here in Winnipeg.
Right.
And that goes back. I got some stories. Oh, the hatred and the combination of love and hate between Saskatchewan and Winnipeg is unbelievable. but you know, it's just, you go to the Labor Day game. I've been there a couple of times and had to walk the walk of shame back to my hotel because they keep beating the shit out of us out there. And then we get them. We get them here on the Banjo Bowl. So little things, but interesting.
Oh. Well, let me ask you, Roy, in terms of the CFL, I mean, I know you know better than anybody where the CFL has been.
Yep.
Where do you think we're going at this point with the CFL?
I don't know if I should say this on a podcast, but I think I need to go get some more scotch. where they're going. Okay, so personal opinion only. After last year with the COVID thing, piddling and diddling and draw people out, and then say we can't play. Okay, fine. You made a mistake. This year, we're going to play. And then we got the Rock and the XFL, which I don't even want to talk about for a minute. And now we're doing the same thing again. And it ain't looking great because Toronto has already announced that they're shutting down all outdoor events for the whole summer. BC's already said that too. So the talk now is if there's going to be a CFL, it's going to have to be in the West, yada, yada, yada. But where I do have a ray of hope is this, guys. I'm a believer, 107 years of Canadian football. If you look, as I said, Saskatchewan and Winnipeg were the only ones in the West, and there was four in the East. I don't care. I really believe that the CFL will survive because, first of all, it's kind of a league unto itself. I mean, we can be cruel and say it's only a feeder league for the NFL, but the NFL seems to like us doing what we're doing. We had a chance for Canadians to play football and show their wares and go to the States. I think it's a very necessary. I maybe I'm wrong. I think Goodell and the boys think that the CFL is pretty necessary to them too. Because as I say, these American guys, when they're and your guys, when they're, well, I want this and I want that. Well, you know what? Go somewhere else. Where else can you show off your skills where Goodell and the boys can watch you and pick you up?
Right.
So I think I'm not sure what form it will take, but I truly believe there'll always be a CFL.
Okay. Well, that's nice to hear. And you're like us, we're on the social media and we see this stuff going around. And for the last 2 months, it has been nothing but pure speculation. So let me ask you, in terms of just what has been speculated, do you have any issue with an alliance with an American League? Not so much a merger, but cooperation across the border to try to make the game better.
The only cooperation across the border that's going to make it work is with the NFL saying, you know, we like you, you know, don't worry, we won't do this, we won't do that. Cooperation won't work because, well, I shouldn't say that, but if you're going to start piddling around with four downs, three downs, getting rid of the single point, getting rid of this, changing the field, ain't going to work. So the only cooperation I can see right now, like I said, Goodell and the boys, I mean, here's probably what I like about the NFL best. God bless them. They will not bow to Toronto with their Toronto center of the world wants an NFL team. They're saying, no, they're not going into Canada. We're not going to do that. To me, that's cooperation.
Right.
So can we cooperate? Yeah. We'll bring your boys up here. If you like them, you know, we'll send them back down. I mean, I think they're treating us quite well. XFL, that's a disaster. Don't even talk to me about that. That is a disaster waiting to happen.
Well, Greg and I have talked about this before, just being American fans of the CFL. That's the thing. To me, as far as the rules, it makes it a better game. To me, it is a more enjoyable game to watch. I like the three downs. I like the long field. I like the 12 players, the rouge. I like everything about it. And that's what, when I first, you know, started hearing all this stuff, that's what was heartbreaking to me, because even as an outsider, which I am because I'm from Birmingham and will be living there again soon, but I feel a certain kinship with the CFL. I mean, I absolutely love the game the way it is. And I just want the CFL to continue. You know, I'd like to see maybe a franchise in Nova Scotia, but beyond that, the way the CFL is now, you know, I just want to see it just keep on going the way it's been going, not financially, but in terms of the way the game is played, because I think it's just a terrific game.
Well, thank you, my friend, both of you. I appreciate that you appreciate it, because, yeah, it's a hell of a game in its own right. Like I told you, I don't know if you go on Google every once in a while. Here's one for you. Like, I sent you that stuff, Greg. Punch in 1972 Western Final in Winnipeg against Saskatchewan. 2 and 3 times out of the end zone getting that ball out. And it was just back and forth. The excitement of that is unbelievable. And, in its uniqueness with the three downs, which is a lot tougher, obviously, because if you run one down, then you better have a pass. So it's a tougher game in a lot of ways. Actually, interestingly enough, one of the things I like about the NFL now is that they've been playing more of the Canadian game, in my mind, the last few years with passing than they ever had before. And there's something about that.
Absolutely a passing league now, for sure.
Yeah, it is. And now, I mean, back in the old days, I was watching the NFL, but man, it drove me nuts. You watch Minnesota, I can't remember the guy's name. I mean, it was like 3 yards, 3 yards, 3 yards on a run. It would drive you. I used to watch these games that were 3-0, 6-3. You know, you fall asleep. And then Cosell and the boys took it over and turned it into an entertainment more than the football in the field. Then it became what it is today. So, yes, the Canadian game is so unique, and I think it's needed. I think the NFL appreciates it, because they get to see guys and get to take them up there, and or down there, pardon me. So yeah, we are unique, and I really appreciate that you guys like it.
It's my favorite. It's my favorite brand of football.
Yeah, mine too. Absolutely. And I just
though with that said, I do like a good solid running game, which is why I love Andrew Harris.
Well, that kind of running game. I mean, Andrew Harris. Well, like, there's a throwback for you. I think I'm writing in this book here. He's a real throwback because Andrew Harris came right out of junior football to the pros. That hasn't happened since the 50s.
Which is, you know, for any Americans listening to this podcast, and I'm sure there are a few, that's something we really don't have here in the States. We don't have a junior program. Our minor league system is college football. But in Canada, if I understand it correctly, there's not only college, but there's also, much like how it is in hockey, you've got these junior programs that are also feeder leagues that feed into the Canadian game.
Most, not as much now, but it's there. Well, Andrew Harris has brought that back. And I don't know if you know the other guy from the Grey Cup, Nick Dembski. Nick is another guy who came out of without university or anything else. In the 50s, 50s and early 60s, our team was stocked with guys out of junior teams. And one of the things I loved the best was Bud Graham. He said, you know what? He said, I have no worries. I could put any Canadian player on the field and they're as good as my Americans.
Nice.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's interesting. Andrew Harris is like a freak of nature, and it's really exciting. That's one of the things I was writing. I did something. I got crazy again saying, you know, we can't survive without Americans. Well, Andrew Harris run through, over, under, around all kinds of U.S. players. They couldn't stop them. Nobody could stop them.
Yeah. It would be – part of me wants to see him come down here, but the other part of me doesn't, because don't want to see him get lost in the shuffle down here at all.
Exactly. Exactly.
If he comes down to the States, I may never see him play again. That's the worry. He'll get buried on some practice roster.
Exactly. No, it's here, and that's just the way it is. And we're great with that. I'm so excited with that. And I love our Canadian players. I sent you something when I was doing my stuff on people harping on the American players. And I said, well, 2013, Saskatchewan won the Grey Cup with what we call the Canadian Air Force. All four of their receivers were Canadian.
I love that. I mean, that's great.
We can do it. We got some great players, but you know, everybody's pushing. Well, you got to have more American. Well, yeah, you know, it's okay, but you know, let's not lose sight.
And I know Scott feels the same way as I do. Honestly, I want to see Canadian players. American players I can see down here. I want to see Canadians play. So to see somebody like Andrew Harris play, or looking back in history, you know, Russ Jackson.
Now that's interesting, because he is the one and only Canadian quarterback to ever have success in the CFL.
And hopefully we will see more kind of after this pandemic, and maybe, fingers crossed, we can hope that you're going to see more Canadian talent maybe come out of this. Hopefully. I mean, it's wishful thinking, but yeah, we can only hope. So, Roy, let me ask you, and if you could tell everybody about your projects, your books, what you're currently working on now, and where to find on the internet. And I know you've got your Twitter account to order these great books, because I got my books directly from you. And
So, well, you're best off at this point. Some of them are still in stores, but I've got them all here. And for me, it's probably, I tell people, you're better off. You've got my email, rosmos@shaw.ca. All they got to do is fire it out to me and I'll make sure they can get the books.
And where on Twitter can we find you?
What am I on Twitter now? Heart of Blue and Gold or Royal Blue?
Okay.
We'll give you some major retweets on your books too, because I think this is fascinating. I mean, for Greg and I who love the CFL, this is our porn right here, you know? so this is just fantastic to talk to you and to have all this knowledge. I mean, this has just really been an honor for both of us.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate
very much. So.
You guys are interested. I mean, I find that fascinating and I love it. And so, yeah, anybody, you know, even if they just done ordering books, they want to know something, give me a call, because I've had a lot of orders from the States too, from guys, different places.
Yeah, I was going to ask, since we started doing the retweets and everything, have sales picked up for you?
Actually, I've gotten a few more from the States. Nice. Come out of nowhere and say, I'm either a Canadian expatriate or I'm a American guy that love your stuff. So yeah, it's really, you guys been good to me. It's really nice.
Yeah. And I apologize. I've not had a chance because when you and I started talking, on my to-do list is building basically a mini website for people to go to, to link to you. So we'll be doing that. I'll be getting that done soon, hopefully. So Roy, any final words you want to say to anybody in terms of just the history with the CFL? I'm sorry, with the Blue Bombers?
No, other than, you know what? If you want to know about the Blue Bombers, they're all in these books. And these are the things to get. You know, I've got them here. You can get a hold of me. I can set you up and fix you up, and you'll find out about the greatest franchise in CFL history.
Awesome. Awesome. Great. Roy, thank you very much. And for everybody listening to the podcast, this has been a presentation of the Sports History Network. And if you're really into sports history research, check out newspapers.com. And you can find that at the sportshistorynetwork.com. There's a link there that will get you signed up for an introductory subscription, and go to sportshistorynetwork.com and link from there. And if you're into football history, and I know Scott used newspapers.com for his great book.
It was invaluable, absolutely invaluable. That's one of the greatest investments I've ever made. Really, I mean, it's just fantastic.
And as I told Scott, the one newspaper that I want, unfortunately, is not on there, but that's my hometown newspaper. But that's another issue altogether.
Well, so, thank you, my new friends. I love you.
Oh, you're welcome, Roy.
Thank you so much, Roy. This has been, it's been an honor and a real pleasure for both of us.
Definitely.
And we could do it again, right?
Absolutely. We will do it again. So, when is the current book that you're working on right now? When do you suspect? When are you seeing that book come out?
Mid-August, early September.
Okay, so let us know. Well, you and I will be talking well before then, but after the book comes out, we'll have you back on again and talk about the book and talk more Blue Bombers history.
Sounds good, buddy.
All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Gentlemen, have a great evening.
This podcast is part of the Sports History Network, your headquarters for the yesteryear of your favorite sport. You can learn more at sportshistorynetwork.com.
We'll shout as you go charging by. We'll send up our cheers to the sky. Behind you we'll stand, you're the best in the land. And we'll shout out our praise on high. Fight, fight, let's fight down the field yard by yard. Let's fight down the field, hit 'em hard. For we want a touchdown team and we want a chance to scream, so fight on, blue heart.